place to be. I'm excited by the good people Chris is involved. Dr. Murray is getting ready to do his thing. Southern University just got a ton of, truckloads, 18-wheelers that come into Southern University and many other schools across the country. Jackson State, when I was at Jackson State, I did execute that program up to about $600,000 or so. North Carolina A&T just purchased $1,200,000 worth of equipment. The key to it is I want to make sure that everybody gets a card, and I'm not going to do a push on that and get to the reason why I'm here. There's a key, there's a secret to it, not a secret, but the deal is that they have a lease to buy program that's very, very easy to qualify for. But I'll give a good example of it. Say if you decide to get $100,000 worth of equipment, and you can put it on a 5-year lease plan, you pay the first $25,000 and you get all of your equipment at one time. And then the next 4 years you pay what? The difference. Simply because they can afford it. You know, you can go out, like Will said, go out and do a couple of Mardi Gras parades and they want to come up with some money to pay for your 1/4 or 1/5. You set up on a 4-year program, 3-year program, they make it work. And the reason why it worked is because the CEO of the company, Mr. John Stoner, made a commitment. His thing is, I like to see every kid who wants to have an instrument in their hands. Recently, I kind of inherited or walked into the program as a result of being the founder and president of the HBCU National Band Directors Consortium, which this organization reminds me of. Mr. Pollock found in his heart and feel soul to do what put this organization together. So you guys could come together and talk and address the needs. I feel like after hearing Al and Will and all this, man, I want to go back and start all over again. I'm excited about what I'm hearing and the kind of things that you're hearing and able to discuss and feel comfortable discussing and questions. This environment is impossible. This type of environment is not possible at the Midwest Band Plant. It's not possible. You can hear a whole lot of stuff. You know, I've attended the Midwest Band Plant probably 40 times throughout my career. Never missed, especially when I was up in the Big Ten, the Big East. I was involved, with on that level. So it's important that you go to the Midwest Band Plant. But when you're able to really get down and get into what it's all about, you gotta have this type of environment, which parallel the reason for the HBCU National Band Directors Consortium. After returning from the mainstream universities after 20 years of being up there and coming back to HBCU schools, where I always wanted to be anyway, but when I returned back to the place where I wanted to be, what I found, it was like deja vu. The concept band programs had not done anything come together. Our founding fathers of our band programs across the country, our people, had stopped going to the Midwest Band Clinics. They were not going to the CBBNA or the National Band Directors Association Convention. Why? Because they were not addressing the needs of our HBCU schools. So what? I got with my colleagues, we established an organization. We first called it the National Black Band Directors Association, and we merged into UofL, and then the HBCU National Band Directors Consortium, which is now available to what high school directors to become involved. A place for us to go and showcase our symphonic band at Jackson State and Norfolk State. Southern University was there. Did I see Patrick walk in somewhere? Yeah, hey man, how you doing? I thought I saw him walk in. He had his symphonic band, a Renaissance sound there. an organization where you can actually go. Dr. Murray is get his act to go and show you, can showcase what can Jackson State supply man get in at the CBDNA play? No. Can Southern University band get an invitation to play? Maybe in the future, but over the years that I've been involved, there are only two HBCU band programs who's performed. And it took politics to get them there. That was Florida A&M and Emory Peters. And that Florida A&M and North State or University. It was all about politics. But so we have what? An organization where we can go and what? Showcase our concert band, which is the most important aspect of anybody's program. That's my lead into this. Now, first question is I ask you, are you ready to do what you need to do to have what total instrumental music program? Are you ready, meaning it? Are your ears on right? Is there a distinction between what the marching band is supposed to sound like? The concert band is supposed to sound like? I ask the question now, and I know the answer. How many of you played in college, played in a band that had an English horn, two oboes, at least three or four flutes, B-flat, E-flat clarinet, counterbass clarinet, E-flat counter, double B-flat counter, two bassoons, five trumpets, at least 45 French horns, then all the way down to what? Full percussion section. I can ask the question, and I can guess that if you went to an HBCU school, I would see five schools represented with that instrumentation. That means that you have not been exposed to what it's supposed to sound like. So that's why it's important for you what? To go to the Midwest band and so you can put your ears on and see what it sounds like. When I came to Jackson State, they never had a full instrumentation symphonic band. When I left Southern University, I had never seen E-flat counterbass clarinet, nor have I heard one sitting on the bottom of that clarinet section. I had never heard that. I hadn't seen the instrument. Couldn't afford it. Not that T. Leroy Davis, who basically was the founder of the band program at Southern University, founding director, T. Leroy Davis had the knowledge because he left what? And went up into the Big Ten and up north, as they said, in order to go to school. Dr. Foster, Florida A&M, had the knowledge. He was fortunate enough to have what? The resources to have that kind of equipment. And I can't think of many more schools who had that. And the first time that I heard a symphonic band, a full instrumentated symphonic band, was my first summer after I graduated from Southern University, and Ludwig Freeman took me in the car and said, "You are gonna go to the Midwest Band Club with me." Drove up to my house in Slaughter, Louisiana, up in Cheneyville. You guys never heard of that area. But drove up to Slaughter, Louisiana, Clinton East High School, Northeast High School, it was Clinton High School then. Got me, told my mom, pack some clothes and take on a meal to the Midwest Band Clinic, because I think he has potential to be one hell of a band. Put me in the car, went up to Michigan. I registered in that summer under the baton of Rebelli, and I heard the symphonic band tune up, and I heard that counter bass clarinet sitting on the bottom, that clarinet section. Man, I was like a kid in a candy store. I heard all of these overtones and coming from all over the place, you know, just the chairs are rattling. You know what I mean? I'm talking about the wheel. I had never heard that before. Now, if you, as a director, never heard that, you gotta fix that problem. First of all, the number one problem now that I see, and I know I'm a straight shooter, is that we are not doing what we're supposed to do on the college level, across the board. Our college band directors are not doing what they
to help the state and to happen with, I mean, how the university wanted to find this kind of circular weapon some in the country, but I'm talking about probably 10 out of the 74 HBCU schools we have with what, band programs. But 10 is full instrumentation, so we're not doing our job to prepare our young directors to what to be ready. But that's in the year of that. Now, you have a responsibility to find out how you want to be ready. You've got to get ready. You've got to know what that, what it sounds like. You've got to not only raise money to get a, what, a Susan Bone to play for the Mardi Gras parade, you've got to raise money to get a real what? A tuba to put in your what? Symphonic band. I know what most of the students are. I've auditioned kids from Seattle to New York, from the Bahamas to you name it, across the country. I know where the musicians are. I know the cities in Chicago. I know where to go in Chicago to find, you know, the musicians that want to come and play the band and the symphonic band at Jackson State or North State or Southern. I know where they're going to find those kids. Many schools that some of you have auditioned. When I was in Norfolk State, I'm looking at some faces I know. But you got to find a way, because what? The success of any toll band program relies on what? How good to the symphonic band. Sound like not a game. Now, what is the difference? We understand that the marching band is bread and butter. Hey, I don't know, everybody else said it got to be a bread and butter of what? A good band program. You gotta keep that thing going, all right, Chris? You gotta have the monster. That's the animal. That's the monster in the program. That's the one that's gonna draw the money. That's gonna make the principal, you know, happy. You know, that's gonna make the presidents at the universities, you know, happy with the marching band out there. I mean, that's the thing that you gotta market. Ain't no question about it. But you have to keep in mind, directors. A good sound is a good sound, but it's what, a marching band or a dancing band? Mm-hmm. A balanced in tune sound, you have to teach that what? Throughout, whichever ensemble, small, I don't care if it's a trombone choir, whatever it is, you have to do it. You can play with more intensity if your band is in tune than out of tune. That's the key. Being able to play a tone in tune, you can get what the intensity that you want to get. But you got to teach the kids how to play in tune. Now, I know all of you heard people say, I like this warm, rich, dark sound. Who knows? How do you get what makes the sound? Once you get that good instrument in your hand that Will is talking about, how do you get a good dark sound from a concert band? Let me hear from somebody. What do you think makes that happen? Yes, sir.
One thing I tell students is, if you have never heard the sound as you're saying, then how do we expect them to make that sound? So that's why the listening is encouraged, going to YouTube, listening to the symphonic bands or symphonies to get those warm sounds, those mature sounds. And yes, you know, I tell them, look, it's not going to happen overnight. But again, like with everything else, the more you do it, the further you get closer to it, that's what we're looking for. And if they understand what that concept is based on their listening and hearing, then a lot of that will carry over into their playing.
It's absolutely. You have to give them some kind of goal. But from a physical standpoint, a good example would be, what about the tone that the air flow? Air flow is so key in that.
Yeah, I was about to say, when I went to Midwestern a couple years ago, my mind got in the moment. But one thing I adapted my program is the breathing gym. You know, I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, but when I got on a couple of years ago, it changed the sound, opening up the throat, the way you breathe. The concept is basically just about how you breathe and the way you do it. Like in sports, when you're running, you don't breathe the same way that you do when you're sitting down watching TV. The breathing gym kind of goes into actual practical ways to breathe and things like that to show them how to open the throat. And listen to the lower tones of that, as well as the instrumentation. You can't have an ensemble with 2 clarinets and 21 trumpets. I mean, there's not going to be any dark sound at all.
Right. Instrumentation, but you got to have that. But the most important, to me, I've learned over the years, the most important thing is not getting time to get and start talking about it. One of these things, we didn't have the technology back then to help. I'm gonna give you guys, man, Will, great job, man, and all of that kind of good stuff. You know, I'm old school, I still have people. But I know how to do it, just don't get that, I know how to do it. Had to learn. If you stay in the game, you got to stay up on what's going on and what's not. But you know, how do you teach tune when you didn't have that instrument that he's talking about? How do you teach the kids? It's not important for the kid to know he's flat or sharp. We just need to know he's out of tune. How do you teach a band? How do you teach them? You teach them, you know, by letting them see, touch, and feel. That's the senses that we have up there. For example, one thing that I do when I go out and guest conduct, and because I had to learn how to do what to deal with middle school and high school directors, because I've been a college director with the exception of 1 year, ever since I walked away from school, which was a disadvantage to me because there are a lot of things that I did not learn in the process, you know, coming up, you know, because that's how you learn. OJT is, you know, what happened. But I remember Mr. T. Leroy Davis, who was my trombone instructor in school. He would just play a note and ask me to start very flat on that note. Say B flat, whatever note it meant, start flat. Gradually move that slide up and stop when the note was empty. Or you can just start on the top side. Play a note that was in tune, and you make me start work on the high side of the note and move forward until I do what? Till the vibration stops. Now, you'd be surprised how quickly the students will learn to hear that. And you can do it in your band class, and you can do it what? You can do it and have everybody be involved in the band class, especially in middle school that I had, even at Glen Oaks, man. I mean, I had that year at Glen Oaks, and I had to learn how to teach. I had every trick in the book in order to be able to teach. As a matter of fact, several of the students who were in that program ended up going to that Southern University band. 4 or 5 years later, I walked in the band room at Southern University. This kid walked up to me, this tall, and said, "How are you doing, Dr. Salmon?" "How are you? And do you remember me?" And I said, "No, I don't remember you." So you started getting on French horn at that point. And a couple of those kids had had it in respect. But going back, and I'm keeping short, I'm going to get out of here on this. But I taught those kids, I had the class involved, I would have a different kid to come up, or I have a trumpet player to come up, and another trumpet player to come up. If the trumpet player that had the best tone, close to in tune, it didn't have to be a beautiful sound. If the other trumpet player with a trumpet that slide more, I had good trumpets because they had bought me new instruments. What happened to those instruments? And then I would have that trumpet player start very flat and pull that slide in, and when that slide got in tune, I had the rest of the kids to do what? So even the percussionists were beginning to hear what? Pitches. I didn't care if they knew they were flat and sharp. We do the opposite thing. We bring the alto saxophone up. We put some cord grease on that slide. We can pull that mouthpiece all the way out. And some of the things that you have to do in order to do what? To be able to what? Teach the kids the tools and the techniques they need in order to do what? Be successful so you get that what? That sound. Now, last thing about, man, I know time is up for me. This, I got to come back. There's a lot of things I want to talk about. But in terms of teaching, talking about that dark side, if you take your hand and put your hand in front of you, your face, everybody please do that. Hands out of your ears. And then you say, do. Feel the half? The half feel kind of what? Cold. Do. Now, let's do. Da. Is that half warm? Try it again. Do. Do. inside of your body when you say da.
Da.
Is that air warm? It's a whole different thing going inside of your, going on in your body. What? When you say da, it opens that whole thing where that air is down coming from what? Down in the gut. That's how you teach a dog sound. And believe it or not, those kids will pick that up like that. All you have to do is what? Maybe be consistent with that. I mean, just do it. Have them to turn their lights. Forget to turn the lights off.
Now, oh, man.
But forget that idea. Somebody start getting slapped upside the head. But what I'm saying is you have to drill this in the kid's head that this is the way I want your gut to feel when you're playing. This is where the air, this is how the air comes from the bottom, from inside the gut. Trust me, people, trust me, I can make it. Well, give me your band for 1 hour, and I guarantee you that will be a difference in the quality of your sound. Just don't want to get him to do what? Breathe and send the air from the right place. So my compliments to Mr. Parker, Ken, and to all of you. I encourage you to do what? To keep this together and grow this organization, you know, so you can come together and talk and please. I live 10 blocks away from the school, away up in Baton Rouge. Came back 5 years ago, bought a home, and I love to come out. It's not about you're not paying me to come. I'm okay financially. Okay. Basically, say 50 years of service, and my wife, Max Kent said, plus concept has been real good. So I'm available. Will knows. I've been in his school 3 or 4 times. All you got to do is make a telephone call. Backroom is not too far from me. No place is not too far. Guess what? If you want me, and you think I can help you, all you have to do is go online to Consell and click on conditions, fill out the application, and Consell will pay me to come and do a session with you if you care for it. I'm not advertising that, but I'm letting you know that what I'm available to do that. Thank you, and I'm available anytime that you want me to come hang out. I wish I had more time, there are a lot of things to talk about, and I just want to stay involved with music and helping you, you guys. My time come and gone. I'm still actively involved from internationally. Just in the last month, I've been down to Virgin Islands twice. I've been to the Bahamas in the last month doing what? We're trying to replace, Consellers trying to replace the instruments that were lost in the hurricane. That's $3 million worth of stuff, that instruments that were underwater, that buildings are falling down, the instruments got all kinds of stuff in them, and so they're trying to replace those. The same thing that's happened down in the Bahamas, so I'm involved with that, and I love it, because I'm building the philosophy of the company is what best fit an instrument in every one of the kids' hands who want to play. So thank you very much.